Do it.
Hi, everyone. My name is Flora Salmon, and welcome to By The Boock. It's an interactive webinar brought to you by our co-hosts, cousins Peter, Danny, and John Boockvar. Peter is a CNBC contributor and CIO of Bleakley Advisory Group. Danny is president at Thrasio, the largest acquirer of Amazon third-party private label businesses, and has 20-plus years of experience leading fast-growing consumer businesses for global brands, such as the NFL and Weight Watchers. John, Danny's twin, is vice chair of neurosurgery at Lenox Hill Hospital and an investigator at the Feinstein Institute for Medical Research. Dr. John Boockvar is also starring in Netflix's original docu-series Lenox Hill, alongside three incredible doctors and our special guests today. Dr. David Langer, chair of neurosurgery at Lenox Hill, Dr. Mirtha Macri, ER doctor at Lenox Hill Greenwich Village, and Dr. Amanda Little Richardson, OB-GYN out in San Jose, California. This exciting series shines a light on the heroic work and unwavering dedication our healthcare professionals exhibit every day. We can't wait to hear more about these four doctors' own personal experiences. I'll be sharing the Lenox Hill trailer to kick off today's episode.
While you do that, I'm just going to tell you that Amanda and Mirtha will be on at about 4:40, 4:45.
Maybe.
So, human being here, everybody, eyes closed, deep breath, a lot of craziness today, obviously. Let's focus on the work.
Let's do a good job for this guy.
Lenox Hill was a sleepy little Upper East Side hospital competing with some of the greatest health institutions in the world.
You cannot choose what comes at you here. It's like the front line.
We deal with death and dying.
I don't even dare to imagine what I'm going to encounter on any given day.
I don't have cancer.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you a little bit about.
I think there's such a thing as a calling.
Yes, that's good.
This is the space I'm supposed to be in.
There's just so much emotional energy that goes into doing this.
The pressure really is intense sometimes.
It weighs on
you. Are you awake?
Open your eyes, sweetie.
Everything we do here is for the patient.
Humanity, empathy, that has to drive the decision making. That's the way to do it.
It's a collage of people that come in.
You're doing so good.
We take whoever, whatever. You have to come here with a really open mind of how these people are feeling.
I want to work with populations medicine has traditionally neglected.
Get angry. Yes, you can. Listen to me. You can. Hold
on to the fire that's deep.
I want that.
I don't care if I gotta get every damn cell.
It's the humanity of your own patient that matters. This is a human being in front of us. You cannot fuck it up. You just can't.
Gentlemen, ladies, ready to roll? Everything
you're about to see what greatness is all about. Worth the
still get chills every time, you guys.
Every time.
All right, we got to do some housekeeping. Peter, you go first.
Amazing stuff. I'm Peter Boockvar. Just a quick disclosure before we begin. Dan and John are not affiliated with Private Advisory Group or Bleakley Advisory Group, and nothing they say should be taken as investment advice, and nothing I say should be taken as medical advice. And I'm going to kick it back to Danny.
Thanks, Peter, and thanks, Flora, for that introduction. Before, I'm Danny Boockvar, president of Thrasio, former CEO of Circle Line Sightseeing, and president of the NFL Experience. I live on the Upper West Side with my wife of 22 years and two teenagers. I am the twin brother of Dr. John Boockvar, the star of Lenox Hill. So over to you, Johnny, for the rest.
Well, first of all, I want to thank all of us for obviously getting together and doing this. I think it's an incredible opportunity. Like I said before, Amanda's gonna be joining us. She's with a patient right now. We'll be jumping on in approximately 6 minutes, and Mirtha as well. But I sit here on the corner of 77th and Lexington, as I do every Friday. And I will tell you, we had a better and better week in the hospital as it relates to COVID. And we only have seven COVID patients left in the hospital, which is just terrific. And the hospital is running at full steam, doing elective cases. It's a completely renovated hospital at this point because of COVID. Telehealth is up and running. So we're in a healthcare situation now, actually, that was better than it was pre-COVID. So we're excited about that. But I'll kick it back to you, Danny, so you can start the program.
Great. So I want to introduce David Langer. David Langer, you are the chair of neurosurgery at Lenox Hill Hospital and professor of neurosurgery and radiology at the Zucker School of Medicine at Hofstra Northwell. You're internationally recognized an expert on diseases of the brain vessels, and it is truly great to have you. And we'll introduce Mirtha and Amanda when they come. But David, we'll start with you. How did this Lenox Hill docuseries come about?
And every time I get asked the question, it's like still fun to, it's like watching the trailer, you know, you're like, it's such a crazy story.
Can't believe this ever.
You know, like John, it's a sliding door phenomenon in life, you know, it's just one of those things that happens. And Ruthie and Adi, the filmmakers, did a similar show in Israel at Ehilov Hospital named Ekilov, two seasons in 2014, 2015. It revolved around a group of doctors. They learned a lot from that experience. One of the doctors in the show is a guy named Erez Nosek, who is a fighter pilot neurosurgeon in Israel, who, after he finished his residency, came to work as one of my fellows, along with Avi Seton, who's an Israeli himself, and Dave Chaliff at North Shore. And unfortunately, I was in the transition to Lenox when he came. It was between 2009 and 2010. I came to Lenox full time. I mean, in 2012 and 2013, I came to Lenox in May of 2013 full time. And Erez arrived in our fellowship in January 2013. But during that time, we became very close, you know, for a variety of reasons. And I taught him a bunch of stuff and saw him as a future leader and really international neurosurgery, and we spent a lot of time together. And lo and behold, you know, a year later, or a year or two later, Erez, I tried to recruit him actually. He spent some time at NYU also. And after NYU, around 20 into 2016, Ruthie and Adi independently decided they were coming to the US to try to duplicate their kind of success here, just because the Israeli TV market is so small. I mean, it's smaller than New York City there as a whole. So they literally took this huge risk, moved their family, their children, moved to Brooklyn, and were looking for an outlet. And they called Erez and said, you know, we'd love to do this with you in the US. They knew he was here. And Erez had just gotten to Maimonides after we failed to recruit him, which is a huge mistake on our part. And he said, you know, I can't do this, but you ought to talk to Langer. So I had dinner with them in early 2017. Netflix was at that point kind of an idea, more of an aspiration rather than a reality. It went from there. You know, we had a lot of work to do in the year of 2017 just to get it through our health system. Primarily, they had their contracts to negotiate, had to work out a lot of the, you know, patient security and privacy issues, legal issues, control issues. This all went on for almost a year's time before we started filming in 2018.
What made you want to be part of it? What was the driving factor for you?
You know, look, John and I have a very unique relationship, and our department's a really unique place, and we have nothing to hide. I feel that we're as talented surgically as any place in the world, that our group as a whole can do anything that any group in the world can do, and that if we have complications or we have issues, everyone has those. So we weren't hiding anything. You know, there was no facade. There never is. So if you're going to do this, there could be a better place to expose ourselves. And that was the kind of the one idea. But the other one was just the lack of a, you know, reasonable representation of healthcare into our youth, primarily my kids. You know, to see them and what they're exposed to was disappointing. With that, I'll turn it over to you and Amanda, because I know she's on a tight window. It's great to see her, and I've heard great things going on for her. So we're so grateful to have her, because we've done these things without her, and I feel empty. So I'm glad you're here.
Hi, Amanda.
How are you?
Good. I'm not Johnny.
I know. I can tell. I actually can. So.
Welcome. Well, we're going to do a brief introduction, and I'll share your background, and then we have a couple of questions for you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Of course.
So, Amanda Little Richardson, you're the former chief resident of obstetrics and gynecology at Lenox Hill Hospital. You moved out west. Bummer for us, but it's exciting for the West Coast. You now work at Kaiser Permanente in San Jose. And I love this part about your bio. You chose to become an OB-GYN because you love working with women. And that's obviously super clear throughout all eight episodes. So welcome. And we're so excited to ask you a couple of questions. First of all, how's the baby?
Oh, she's doing really well. I mean, I need to probably post a picture of her on Instagram or Facebook, because that's the number one question. How is Ava? So she's doing really well. We're really grateful for her. She's just I mean, she's 15 months now, so she just hits the ground running, like, right when she wakes up in the morning until she goes to bed. She's running everywhere, constantly, like, jibber-jabbering, as we say. But she's great. Thank you for asking.
That's great. So, obviously, I'll jump right into a question. You know, you focus so much on populations that are traditionally neglected, and that was so meaningful for you when you became a doctor. So obviously on today being Juneteenth, I'd love to just ask that question and how meaningful that is to you and your service to the Black community from a medical standpoint.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I'm happy that you mentioned Juneteenth because I was wondering, I'm like, how can I bring that up? So happy Juneteenth. So, and for
happy Juneteenth
your listeners
to you,
that don't know, so it's June 19th, 1865. So it represents the presence or arrival of Union soldiers to Galveston, Texas, and the remaining freed slaves in Texas. And so for within the African-American community, we really feel like this is when all the slaves in the South were truly freed versus that's 2.5 years after the Emancipation Proclamation. So that's why it's such a celebratory day. And, you know, in terms of, I think that in healthcare, there's so many studies that show about provider bias toward patients of color and how we assess their pain. And, you know, when we look at maternal health specifically, you know, the death rate of Black mothers, regardless of socioeconomic background, is much higher. So, you know, when thinking about slavery, particularly for me, I think it's interesting what kind of epigenetic changes or small changes may have happened in the past that continue to be carried down like generationally through birth and genetic wise that continue to kind of affect poor outcomes for women. But I think recognizing that provider bias can help to correct those issues. And, you know, California is great in that they have the California Maternal Health Quality and Care Collaboration, which looked at initiating basically checklists. If a patient presents with X, Y, and Z, how can we treat everyone the same in terms of initiating medication, you know, promptly, intervening early versus waiting? And so that really helped to improve maternal mortality here, and that's being implemented nationwide as well. So I think those sort of things will help to continue to improve outcomes for Black women. And I think having an advocate that's really trying to talk about those issues, because I think talking about it is the first step to improving it. So we have to recognize the problem before we can come up with the solution.
Dr. And I think the show does a great job at that, Amanda.
Yeah.
So
I was
Peter Sarva,
really happy with that. Yeah, they did a great job.
Yep.
Dr. Richardson, I'm cousin Peter of Dan. it's great to meet you online. I thought you were amazing on the show. I loved your family. I have to believe that over the next couple of months, you're going to be getting calls from every pregnant woman in the Bay Area to say, can you please deliver me?
That is really kind.
I mean, honestly speaking, I mean, this has been just such incredible exposure. Yeah. Are you guys preparing for a big increase in business for that because of this?
We're preparing for a big increase in business because of COVID and
COVID, right.
Social isolation at home. So we anticipate a lot of deliveries from that alone. You know, I think that, you know, I work with a great group of partners here. So, you know, we're ready for whoever wants to receive services from us. We're happy to receive them. And I think that I work with such a good team that everyone provides good services. I don't do call every day. So even if someone were to become my patient, I may not deliver them, just depending, but we are all providing that sympathetic, caring, and like excellent pregnancy and GYN care.
Well, that's one thing as a viewer, when you watched, you know, all four of you, just the importance of the team and mm-hmm. how amazing each one of you had these teams and the rapport that you people that all you had that you had with all with your team and how important that is to be successful in what you do.
Yeah, I agree. I think that it's really important. I think that Dr. Langer did such an excellent job bringing Dr. Boockvar and such a good team of clinicians to the neurosurgery department. And I really think that I was talking with my husband, we're watching the show, I'm like, this is the chief that every department needs in every institution, because he not only continues to practice clinical medicine, so I feel like he is really has a pulse on what's happening in his field, but he's recruiting people and he's really focused on the teamwork aspect. And I think if you don't have the teamwork, you can't work in medicine. You have to have people that support you, but also have the same commitment to patient care as the priority versus whatever else BS that people want to bring. And I think that Dr. Langer is a true leader, and you can see that in the show as well.
Yeah, definitely.
And, I usually ask on this show the health-related questions. That's where.
Okay.
One of the scenes that I think is one of the best that I had never seen before is when I think it was Dr. Brennan and you told the woman to grab her own baby and essentially deliver it herself.
Yeah.
My jaw dropped to the ground.
I mean, the baby's out. Most important thing is delivery of the shoulders. Once the shoulders are out, everything else pretty much falls out. So I do think that that's growing in popularity. I think the big celebrity that made it popular was Kourtney Kardashian. She talked about that. So a lot of patients desire that. And if baby's doing well, I think there's no problem.
Yeah, you basically halt the delivery, put the two hands, it's like grabbing a stability ball and just, it was inspiring. Honestly, so many of those scenes were inspiring. I cry every time.
Who was born first, John or Danny?
What's this?
Who was born first, John or Danny?
First, there is one funny story about our twin delivery. I was born first.
That's why it was so easy for Dan to get out.
Paved the way.
They lost our placentas at birth, Amanda. So we never knew if we were identical or fraternal back in those days. And so to this day, our placentas are still missing. And so we have no idea if we're identical.
That's true story.
Make a couple phone calls for us.
And my uncles are twins. And how she found out she had twins is she went into labor and they're like, oh, right. There's another head. Yeah. So this is like 1960, I think. So, you know, that's a step up that, you know, it's only the placenta. Yeah. At least your mom knew she was having twins.
Well, she found out the day before.
Okay, well.
I have a question about that, Amanda. When did you find out in the filming process, when you guys booked Netflix, you weren't obviously... Or what stage were you in, or was this just
They actually started filming toward the end of my third year, and I had timed my pregnancy, so I became pregnant in around like July, August, so maybe about 6 months after they started.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, and then I have one other question before, you know, it's Father's Day, and you got, you know, on Sunday, we talked about how, you know, sensitive you are with women. You know, what do you tell your young dads when you hand them the baby in honor of Father's Day?
Yeah, what do I tell my young dads? I mean, I think that, I hope I didn't give the impression that fathers and partners are not important to the process, because they really are. As you saw in my own labor, my number one thing was unlimited support. So I think that, you know, it is a physically demanding process for the woman, right? But whoever the dads, as you're supporting the mom, that's actually so beautiful. And sometimes we don't see that actually. So just being there, listening to her needs, and then that moment of delivery is yours as much as it is hers as well. And I think that, I know that for Kevin, despite him trying to take a selfie, which was like a momentary lapse in judgment, his main goal was to say, oh, this is the last moment, it's just you and I before this third person comes. And it's just a beautiful moment. As long as you're there and communicating, you have a good relationship, it's fine. And God knows, as you see, I'm attached to my daddy. So I always, dad's partners.
Dr. Macri.
Hi.
Welcome. Guys,
how are you?
Welcome.
We're all together telephonically or whatever the word is. So, Mirtha, you're dropping in. I know you're
Hi, Mirtha. I'm Danny Boockvar. Nice to meet you.
Yes. I mean, you're twins.
Yeah. I'm a cousin, Peter Boockvar. Nice to meet you.
Hi, Peter, love
the show.
Thank you.
I know, Amanda, you have to drop off soon, but feel free to stay on. I want to introduce Mirtha and make sure we get your bio and tell everyone your background. So thank you for joining us as well. Dr. Mirtha Macri, you graduated from New York College of Osteopathic Medicine in 2008. You're now an ER doctor at Lenox Hill Greenwich Village, as we know from watching you in action. You completed your residency near me on the Upper West Side of Mount Sinai West, where you probably took care of some of my kids' broken bones in the ER. So thank you a lot of broken bones up there. And welcome. It was just so inspiring watching you and so inspiring now seeing the four of you together. So we're going to continue to ask questions. And I guess, Mirtha, what was it like being filmed? And tell us about the experience.
So, you know, I've never done anything like this before. I don't know if any of you others have, but this was completely new to me. Luckily, it was with Ruthie and Adi, who are just extraordinary individuals who from day one felt an immediate trust, comfort, that I don't think probably would have been possible without them present. Their views on healthcare and many issues in life in general were very similar to mine, and I felt this comfort level with them that was just really great, and it helped me relax in front of the camera. And also their approach to filmmaking is really non-intrusive, especially in a setting that's so sensitive like the one we're working in, where they had utmost respect for families and privacy and my space in particular. I sometimes felt like they weren't even in the room, so that definitely eased things a little bit. But I mean, in the beginning, I was definitely very nervous and had no idea what I was doing.
Well, I already said it, having David with me, across the hall made it so much easier. I have such respect for the two of you to do this on your own.
You had a buddy, yes.
Yeah, I had a buddy the whole time. He's annoying at times, but at least
but at least it was like a little co-pilot, the both of you.
Absolutely.
Do that. Dr. Macri, what amazes me about being an ER doctor is that you never know what's going to come through the door. So you really have to specialize in so many areas of medicine. Like, how do you, with other doctors in the ER, how's the division of labor go, where you focus on certain ailments and other doctors focus on others, or are you just taking care of whatever comes your way?
Yeah, it's not separated. Some ERs have a fast track area where they take, more basic cases. Our emergency, first of all, we're at the first standalone ER in Manhattan. So it's unique to us. So we're a small entity still. We're also very new. We've only been open for 5 years. We're about to hit our anniversary in July. So our department's rather small still. So we don't have a fast track. We don't have a dedicated pediatrics, a dedicated trauma. It all just comes into, the providers who are working that day, you just get patients and there's no choices. I have worked at bigger institutions like where I trained, where you had a dedicated PDR, trauma, things like that. But for the most part, I like this setup a little better because I could do everything, so as opposed to just working in fast track.
Yeah. I found one of the most moving scenes was, in somewhat in honor of it being Pride Month, when you had the Pride Parade, and it must have been, it could have been June, I guess, or I don't know exactly, because there was the Pride Parade.
It's but July.
It was July, right? So it was, and we talked a bit about how both you and Amanda have serviced, traditionally very neglected communities, but that was just such a powerful episode. So do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, we have a pretty large LGBTQ community in the West Village, actually. Very large transgender community. So that is a very, our patient population is very concentrated in that area, actually. So, and the Pride of Parade actually comes right in front of our doors every year. So I actually find those nights the best. It's so great. But they come to our ER, and it's great because we do try to make as many resources as we can for them. They are also a very underserved community. There's not enough resources in clinics for them, for example, just to get retroviral medications for HIV, STD testing. Clinics are backed up. So we serve a lot of those resources for this population. And our social worker is usually, she's only there during the day. So at nighttime, I don't have her, which is very challenging. So we end up communicating in the daytime through emails, like, I saw so-and-so, I need you to help him out or her out. And sometimes I've left them in the waiting room waiting for a social worker in the morning, and she's very busy. She's very
busy. Say before I sign off that, you know, Mirtha, Dr. Macri, I was just really moved by your compassion toward your patients. And also, you know, I had friends texting me saying, I didn't realize that the ER had so many homeless patients or that there were so many other difficulties aside from just broken bones. So thank you for showing America, you know what, all the aspects of goes on in emergency care in this country and the need for probably primary care access for people to go to places outside of the ER. But it's been great to see all of you guys. Miss New York every day. But California is good too.
Amanda, when you watch the show, don't you get nostalgic for New York?
I get so nostalgic. And actually, one of my really good friends is actually in the Pride scene walking with her fiance.
Oh, that's so great.
Boyfriend. Yes, and she was waving a Pride flag. So that's New York. You'll meet, it's a small, big town, right? You see everybody everywhere.
Well, before you go, make sure to report back to us December, January, so we can quantify the amount of COVID conceptions that took place.
We'll definitely report on that. Have a good day, everybody.
Thank you again.
Amanda. So nice to see you.
See you.
Bye.
Thanks, Amanda.
I do think it was such an ode to New York, the show. It really had beautiful skylines. The Pride scenes were so authentic. The subway shots of you all walking out of the office were spectacular and just really moving. So I could see being so nostalgic watching that from afar. So how have the last 3 months been, Mirtha, with COVID?
It's been pretty tough. It's been tough. I think New York though is doing better right now. I think we suffered a huge hit in New York, being the epicenter. And I think it hit home really hard for everybody. Not just patients, but like the providers, the doctors, the staff, everybody. You know, it's something that I never imagined I'd experience in my career, and I'm rather new, but I've never experienced this before. I wasn't around during the AIDS epidemic, but this seems to be worse in some people's eyes. I can't speak for that. But I think New York is doing really good. It's strong. It's a strong city. My views on New York City have changed a little bit. So I'm probably not going to leave for a little while. But we held it together, and the health system was incredibly supportive of everyone.
I'm assuming you're going to get visitors to the ER just to meet you.
Oh, I don't know.
After popping the show.
I don't know about that. But maybe. I mean, I'm happy to meet anybody.
Right. So things at your ER have gotten back to normal or stabilized?
I mean, and definitely not normal. I don't know that they'll be normal for a long time, but the volume has gone down significantly. We've seen numbers of COVID go down very much. You know, so those are all good things. I do think that a lot of people left New York City for a little while. So we'll see what happens in the fall.
So to that point, is there going to be any like stepped up planning in the fall when people say, oh, it's going to come back, and just the seasonality of it, that do you try to increase staff ahead of that, or you just sort of play it by ear?
I think we've been playing it by ear this whole time, and we'll probably do the same. I think that New York is going to be prepared as we can be. Right. That's how I feel, but I don't, you know, I hope if when there is a second wave, if there is one, that we'll be prepared. I think that we came together so quickly during the first wave, and you know,
that you know, it was Peter, we're anticipating having to set aside about 30% of each hospital for COVID patients come fall. So with that mindset, we're readying the hospitals in ways that we really weren't prepared. I would say we were caught flat-footed for the first wave. And as we anticipate a second wave, we don't want to shut down elective surgery again. We don't want to close the doors, but we were going to have to set aside 30% of our hospital. The question now is how to do that ahead of time. So now we have COVID elevators, we have COVID floors, we're going to have COVID entrances. Right, you know that. And that's going to all be set up ahead of time, so we don't have to shut down the elective business. You know, all major health systems in New York City lost about $1 billion over 3 months each. And so when you're a not-for-profit with a 1% operating margin, you can't have that happen twice in a year. Right. It's unsustainable. So that's what I think we're anticipating.
even in our standalone ER, we were able to build, come together and build a COVID floor, essentially, up there with 20-something spots. And that was done in a week, a little bit over a week. So I imagine the second time around will be smoother, and we'll be prepared.
And also a lot of lessons learned in terms of treating the patient as well, right?
Definitely. Things we learned along the way. We had to learn them along the way. We didn't know.
One of the things that our pulmonary critical care team here at Lenox, and I know Mirtha, you did this probably, is early use of steroids. A study came out of Oxford this week that showed dexamethasone, which is Decadron, a drug that David and I use in all of our brain patients. The early use of Decadron was eminently successful in treating the disease. And that's just a cheap drug that if we use early. So I think we're gonna be better prepared come fall for sure.
Hey, David, if you don't mind, you know, answering this question, I think, Johnny, you've answered it in prior weeks, but how do you think neurosurgery and your field has been most affected by the pandemic? And what do you think the future looks like?
Well, first of all, we realize we're not the top of the food chain all the time. I mean, neurosurgeons tend to have a high opinion of themselves. And I think this was, remarkable in that people that never got attention and no one talked about suddenly were the leaders that we needed. That was terrific because that created some balance and you need everyone on board for this. The big picture, I think that the lesson I think that John and I are trying to really push forward, and this thing above here is a function of that. What's great about this thing behind me is that an excellent John thought of it. We were playing these different things, and we have this butterfly, which the idea of how we're going to come out from COVID better than we went in, like we emerge as a something better. And I think we all have to do that. Chaos breeds change, and that this is not the first time there's been chaos. And if you look at even our Fortune 500 companies, many of them grew out of massive changes, whether it's economic changes, social change. You can see Tesla basically grew out of essentially a green movement as an example, but maybe not quite as the same, but I think it's our responsibility not to go back to business as usual. And so in our department, we're really trying to really maximize in every way that we can, you know, some of the tools of COVID, and this conference is one example of that. You know, who would have, By the Boock was originally going to be, something different. And now here we are on a WebEx, you know, in a Zoom meeting. And so I think the lesson of this conference and the lesson of Tesla and the lesson of COVID are all similar in that it's our responsibility to not go back to where we were and take advantage of this experience to make ourselves better. And I think that's what we intend to do. And I think New York is going to benefit from this. There's all concerns about New York City. This is going to ramp New York even more because I don't think it's unique to medicine. That the environment in New York City will be forever changed for the better. And we will have a great advantage on people who haven't been through this or weren't forced to make those changes. I know a lot of our colleagues, they're just right back doing the same as usual. They shut down, they went back, and nothing changed. We're gonna have a huge advantage on them. And I look forward to seeing us really shine forever because of this.
David, something somewhat related to that point. One thing I was amazed by the show with you and John was the incredible technology that you guys have to do the things that you do. When you look back 20 years ago, for example, and the tools that you had to do this, I mean, so much must have changed, and I guess giving you the ability to do so much more today relative to then.
Yeah, I mean, our fields, you know, one of the reasons why people who can be empathetic can actually work as neurosurgeons now is because we're not destroying people. You know, and even 20 years ago, I mean, when I was training, the guys were not like us. I mean, not at all. When I was told, one of my dad's best friends, I was going into neurosurgery, told me I was insane. Like, you can't possibly do that, you know, and because people like us didn't go into neurosurgery because it was just, you just were literally annihilating people. And part of that was we didn't have the navigation. We didn't have the imaging. The procedures were much more morbid. I mean, I literally, there's some days I do case, and I don't know how these guys did what we're doing with the tools that they had. It's just you had to be almost you couldn't possibly have let any emotion in. So what this is, it's humanized us. I mean, we can't afford to do the things we did before. I go into John's OR, and we do things very differently, but it's all the same ethic. You know, John has a real way of approaching the patient, both out and in the OR, and I've learned from watching him, and I believe he's learned from watching me. And because we have that kind of relationship, the technology becomes as part of the continuum of care. And, you know, I push him a little bit because I'm a little bit more of a, you know, more of a, I'm willing to take a little, do a little bit more crazy stuff, you know, than he sometimes is. But then he grounds me because he's like, you know, dude, that's just stupid, you know. And he makes fun of some of my equipment and I, you know, put it right back at him. But that's what makes our department great. And what you saw was an expression, not just of the technology, but of the kind of like way we've sort of sussed it out and used it in an effective way. Because there's tons of technology out there, but there's some that just frankly isn't that great. It's expensive. And I think we're smart enough to know what we need to do. And our department, I think, is, with the exception of the exoscope, I think we have more or less probably middle of the road as far as the technology the average neurosurgical department has, yet I think our ethic makes it much more valuable.
You know, Peter, to answer that question, when I was at Cornell, it was a much larger department. We run at Lenox Hill Neurosurgery much like a Silicon Valley startup. And so we have an interaction amongst ourselves and a number that allows us to try new technology. We are in a healthcare system that really understands innovation and promotes innovation. We have innovation awards from Northwell Health. So I think under David's leadership, we created a culture where we can take some risk with new technology. We have the support of the administration, and that's what's moving the field forward. And as David said, when we were both at Penn during our residency together, the average brain tumor surgery could be 6 or 8 hours. Not only is that emotionally draining, it's physically draining, it's psychiatrically damaging. And I don't like to do a case that's more than 3 or 4 hours if I can help it. And that also helps me get home to my family at night, which is emotionally grounding. So, you know, one of the things that I love about this show is, and I'm glad that they involved all of our families, our children and our spouses, because it emphasizes to the future generation of neurosurgeons that it's actually okay to go home, because there's peer pressure in medicine and there's a lot of pressure to go out for dinner at night and go to a recruiting event or do a departmental this. But unless you, at an early age, start balancing your work-life responsibilities, you can always be at work. There's always enough to do. And so I think we're fortunate that we're able to do that.
Two moments in the, and I won't reveal too much, but about the technology was one. Mirtha, obviously you showed us that a good old-fashioned gauze pad is still sort of the best piece of technology there is. But there's also a scene in surgery, I think it's Mitch or somebody, who says, I'm old school. And he also is sort of using some non-technical thing. So I think, Peter, the question's a good one, because the show really showed us that still there's some good old fashioned tech like gauze that's still used, but all this camera wizardry that I don't think any of us had any idea that you guys were able to use. David, the other thing that stood out to me was sort of the business of medicine. And a couple of times during this series, you talk about being a department chair, the business of medicine. And as a guy in business running teams and having goals, I was surprised to hear you talk so candidly about the business of medicine and hitting goals.
Yeah, it's funny. My mom, when I was a medical student, I started medical school in 1986. And only one of my classmates, or two, were in Wharton at the time. Penn was a very dynamic place, and the Wharton School has this big reputation. And we all looked down on people who were in Wharton. It was like, what are you doing that for? Like, you know, I was like Mr. Frickin', you know, do-gooder, and I want to save lives, and how could you possibly, you know, consider Wharton? You know, you're like soiling yourself or something for even, you know, learning about economics. And, you know, it was kind of a sort of taboo. You know, fast forward to now, my mom hears me talk, she says, remember when you were used to tease people for being in Wharton? I was like, yeah, I know. But that's, I think, a reflection of the, you know, John and I, and I think maybe me a little bit more. You know, I finished my residency in 1998. It was just the beginning of this massive change in healthcare. Of, you know, I show a graph in some talks of the number of administrators, how that's grown in the past, you know, 15 years, and the number of doctors essentially stayed the same, and this huge administrative overlay. But what happens is that the truth is that the best and brightest have to be, you know, have to be comfortable with that. And especially now, we never could have built a department like this 20 years ago. The incentive structures were different. There were no full-time doctors. You know, that's why healthcare was so kind of compartmentalized, and everyone was, you know, fighting for their own, you know, piece of dirt. You know, that I think our department's a reflection of the good part of the bureaucracy, that we have a, you know, a cohesive and coherent strategy. And, you know, I think that that came through. I tell people all the time, you know, I was excited to do the show primarily to show these cool OR scenes. I thought that would be really impactful, and to see, whoa, like neurosurgical anatomy and all this amazing stuff that we was the reason why we did this. And in fact, the OR scenes were, they were cool, but what really created this massive, I think, kind of empathy for our field and for healthcare workers was this kind of thing. And seeing what we do outside of the OR, whether it's like John said, our home lives, Mirtha's reactions to, you know, people in the middle of the night and people have nothing and their insurance problems. And those are the things in this show. In addition, I think that the fifth character was New York City that, you know, really created this. I couldn't be more amazed at how this came out. If you told me this is what it's going to look like, I would have lied to you. But the bureaucracy thing was valuable. And just because they were flying the wall, I decided from early on I was going to be myself. And whether it made it in is up to Ruthie and Adi. And they turned into poetic license. We gave them poetic license.
Mirtha, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I agree 100%. I mean, they're artists. They created this beautiful series that, and I really love the way they had the city, despite all this chaos and all these sick people we were seeing, all these disparities that we talk about on the show. Whenever they portrayed New York City, it was really quiet. I think that David and John make a reference to that, how quiet the city mm-hmm. looks, even though there's so much complexities, you know, all around you all the time while you're at work, but the city is just like this silent backdrop almost.
I don't think we could have done this show anywhere else. It wouldn't have been as impactful. Now we're lucky to work here. I'm it's one of the reasons why I'm a doctor in New York. You know, I know that that's what makes it so. I worked in Long Island for 3 years before I came back. I had trouble, you know, there's nothing wrong with Long Island. It's just that it's just a different, you're filtering differently. It's just not the same. And, you know, it's not good or bad. It's just once you get used to that and used to the pace and the energy and the patience and what people come with, it's hard to explain. And I think that the show reflects that. And that's why it is Lenox Hill. You know, it's not some other hospital. And that's what made it so unique.
So I know we don't have much more time, but are we allowed to talk about what's dropping next week?
Oh yeah, John can tell you.
Netflix is excited to announce that on June 24th, we'll have a special COVID episode called Pandemic, which is a 30-minute special on our experience at Lenox Hill Hospital and Lenox Hill Greenwich Village on our experience with COVID over the last 3 months. So very powerful. And obviously it's doesn't have obstetrics and neurosurgery. I won't give it away, but it's an incredibly powerful end to this season, if you will.
Can't wait to watch it.
And that drops on Wednesday.
Yes.
I believe so, yes.
Yeah, that's great. So Peter, any further questions?
No, I just want to just credit the four of you. It was really just amazing to watch and just the appreciation that we have for the things that you guys do.
I echo that. It was really inspiring and such amazing work. I think couldn't have been more timely. And, you know, we're deeply appreciative of it all. And deeply appreciative of you, Mirtha, for taking the time to join us, and David, you for joining us, and we'll thank Amanda again. It was terrific to hear your experiences and share your experiences. And for our listeners, make sure you tune in not only on Wednesday, but if you haven't yet, tune in to see the extraordinary docu-series Lenox Hill on Netflix. And with that, we'll wrap it up and see you all next week.
Thank
Have a good
you.
Weekend, everybody.
Thank
Happy Father's Day.
Thank you. Have a great weekend.
You
Bye-bye.
Too.
Bye.